We were looking for a classic beach cruiser that didn't come with a classic price tag. At $2,000, I found the ideal candidate price-wise, a 1963 Corvair. But I just hope this junkyard find isn't one step beyond being rescued.
Now, Mike mentioned that there was some nasty fuel in the tank, it was all very stale, so I'm going to drain that out. And it sounds like it's not too full either, so hopefully this shouldn't take too long. Right, so I've now replaced all the old fuel with fresh stuff, so now I can change the battery. Might not be it. So let's have a look. Well, we know we've got fresh fuel. Perhaps we haven't got a spark. Now, this clever little device here has a little light bulb in there, and what I'm going to do is put this in between the actual coil and the king lead, and the idea is that then there is a spark, the light will actually light up. Oh, look at that! So if you've got a good spark and fresh fuel, but it's still not firing, then obviously the fuel isn't getting into the engine. Now, I can't actually smell any fresh fuel in the carburetor, so maybe I'll just give it a helping hand, a dash of fuel down each carb, and hopefully she'll fire up. That's fantastic. It does actually run. Mike was telling the truth, and it does sound quite strong as well. But now we get to have a look underneath. Look at that crazy camber. That comes from the swing axle suspension. That's really the root of this car's reputation, or bad reputation, but we can sort that out. Now, what I'm really interested in is the condition of our engine. As you can see, it's absolutely covered in oil. Now, there's two main places this is going to come from. One, from the gasket around the sump plate there, but also inside you've got the pushrod tubes, and of course, being air-cooled, it runs slightly hotter than a water-cooled engine. Some of those seals tend to perish a bit early, and of course, they end up with oil leaks. Now, the only way I can know for sure is by taking some of this stuff apart and actually have a look inside. Well, if we have a look up inside here, you can see at the very top, you've got your three air-cooled cylinders with those cooling fins on there. And then beneath that, you've got these six tubes. Three of them, at least, are actually pretty covered in oil. As I suspected, that means the seals have gone, so they'll need to be replaced. But I might also replace all of them, because, of course, the others may well be close behind. This is definitely one way of ensuring that the oil leak stops. I'll probably have to put some more back in there. Now, I could probably actually change the pushrod tube seals on the engine itself, but there's so many other things I'd like to have a look at. I think the better thing to do is to take the engine and gearbox out as a lump and actually pop it onto the bench and have a better look that way. Right, so with the clutch cable now disconnected, that's all the fiddly stuff on the underside of the car, so now I need to go topside and start fiddling up there. Right, so everything is now disconnected. With any luck, when I lift this lift up, the car body is going to rise, the engine and gearbox are going to stay attached to that bench. So here goes. Right, so our engine is out of the car. I've attached it to this little engine stand right here. I've even given it a bit of a clean so I can see what is going on. First up, I'm going to sort out those pushrod tube seals. Having got our rockers off, I now need to make sure that I keep them in pretty much the same order, because of course all these surfaces have now kind of worn and got used to each other. So what I'd like to do is just pop this little pushrod through a bit of cardboard here. And then what I'm doing is also they're going to put the rocker on the end of that. Handily, everything fits nicely. nearly there. I'm just undoing these last six bolts. Right, so that's the last of those little retaining plates. And now I can have a go at getting out our pushrod tube. Now, these pushrod tubes have been in here a long time, so the seals are actually gripping, even though they're leaking. I really can't get it. Now, the factory recommend actually tapping them out with a special tool. Seems a little violent, so I'm just going to try this tool. I've got a little bit of rubber. Just goes into the jaws to stop them from actually damaging the pipe. Right, so I've got it moving. So now what I'm going to try and do is lever it up, which is wonderful. Look at that. So, that's it. So what's actually been leaking is little O-rings, top and bottom. And of course, over time, the O-ring gets hard if it moves around, because it's expanding and shrinking all the time. And of course, that means the oil can actually start kind of leaking past. So we change that on all of these and on both sides, and hopefully that'd be one leak stopped. Now, it's a little bit softer than I was expecting, but you can still see it hasn't got a very good profile. It's still actually flat on the edge there. And of course, it's that flat which is actually letting the oil through the seal. So once I've refreshed all of these with new seals, we should be good to go. Right, so that's the last of those on this side. Obviously, they need a bit of a clean up before they go back onto the car. I'll need some new seals, and I think I'll get some new gaskets as well. Adding a little lube to the O-rings will help me fit them onto the end of the pushrod tubes. Getting the pushrod tubes back into the engine is a bit fiddly, but with a bit of motivation, they slip back in nicely. As soon as these last two little pushrod tubes have been pushed into place, we have then fixed both reasons as to why we could have oil leaks on this engine, which would be fantastic. And then we can crack on making it look lovely. Last of these little O-rings in here, just go underneath the retainers. It's kind of interesting that these guide plates, or the bolts at least that hold them in, are doing two jobs. They're not only holding the guide plates in position, but of course they are also holding the head down, which is why it's really important to actually get the torque setting correct, because of course if it's too little, then you're going to get with exhaust gases actually blowing out between the barrels and the head, and if it's too tight, well of course you could actually shear them off and they break, and of course they'd leak again. So because this is air cooled, what you tend to find is that things actually kind of get loose often because of all the heating up and therefore expanding, and then they're shrinking again when they cool down. Every single time you actually use the car and then park it up, it's worth actually on an air cooled engine checking the torques, particularly if your head bolts, quite a regular occasion, and probably twice a year wouldn't hurt actually. Now, when you see this wonderful Corvair engine in its naked form with all the tinware removed, you can actually start to see all the similarities between it and the flat four Bug engine, but also the flat six Porsche 911 engine. In fact, this engine predates the Porsche by about 3 years. And in fact, GM spent a couple of million quid in about 7 years developing it, so they are way ahead of the game. But thankfully, all of that development work did pay off because it's incredibly reliable.
Click here to subscribe.